10, 10, 10.
All right, we're recording over here. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Let's do this. Here we go.
Politic 3 program is reinstated.
Open sesame!
Commander Klingon vessel, we are energizing transporter beam. Now.
Welcome, everyone, to Star Trek from the Holodeck. I am the captain of this vessel. I am Captain Michael Flores. And I'm on the bridge of this ship with my... You know what? He's no longer an ensign. He's been demoted. You're now a cadet. And I'm going to test you, David.
At least I wasn't killed off by Tribbles.
No.
Okay?
Well, last episode, I wanted to kill you off. But now I'm just going to test you. Here, put this leotard on.
Is this new Starfleet regulation?
Now, let's see. The scenario is, in order to be a lieutenant, you're going to have to do some things. See, my test, Pike is an honorable man. He does a fair test. Me, my test will be definitely sexual. So dumb. All right, so today we are here to discuss the final Enterprise-focused short treks of the second season of Short Treks.
Seems it, yeah.
Episode 3, titled Ask Not, the synopsis, when an attack on Starbase 28 leaves a surprise prisoner under Cadet Thera Sidhu's watch. Am I saying that name right? Thera Sidhu's?
Sidhu. Oh, man.
Sidhu. We're uncultured.
Yes.
On this network. Hi. So, Thera Sidhu's watch, she is faced with making a decision that may threaten her standing in Starfleet. Directed by Sanji Seneca and written by... You know what? Who wrote this episode? Kalinda Vasquez wrote the episode. So this show, Short Treks, I should say, this little, I don't know, filler between seasons has become a bit of a proving ground for fresh, budding talent. Maybe almost like a farming league.
Kind of, yeah. It's kind of like a setup league for like the creative team and stuff. In Star Trek.
Yeah, it's like, hey, if you do well here and your episodes are great and people like what you do, guess what? We're also going to bring you on board one of the top tier TV shows coming out.
Well, look at last season with, I believe Michael Chabon did like,
yep.
Who was the one that, which one was it that he did?
Yeah, I believe he wrote the first episode.
The first episode,
yeah.
Wasn't it?
Yeah.
And he just knocked it out of the park.
Yeah. The first episode of this season's of Short Treks. Yeah. Yeah. I definitely enjoy these. I know we still have a few more to go before the end. But the reason why I'm talking in kind of like almost like past tense is because this is the final one for the Enterprise crew.
Yes.
And they made a big deal about that on social media, and they should. I don't think it's debatable at this point that some of the best elements from season two, besides the very focused, centralized story we had opposed to last season or the first season of Discovery, felt a little bit all over the place. They were trying to find themselves. Besides the fact that season two of Discovery felt good and concise and tight, I mean, one of the best elements, outside of the obvious, is the inclusion of the Enterprise crew. And I don't think a lot of us expected to really, truly enjoy that. I know myself, as a Star Trek fan, I was very hesitant. Like, do we really want to see Pike right now? Do we really need another new Spock?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I remember our past shows. Me and you were really skeptical about it because, like, there's a chance that basically that they could have actually really angered the fans to the point that the fan base would have become toxic.
Well, we were already in such a weird place. You know, the Star Trek fandom was already a little on the fence about this whole new era, this new Star Trek universe, as they're calling it. And there are still some of the alleged purists. I hate calling them purists because I believe I'm a Star Trek purist, but I also am not narrow-minded. I'm willing to see change, and or I should say I'm willing to accept change. I know that if we don't change and we don't grow, the franchise will just continue to falter and and just slip into obscurity. And that's where Star Trek was heading. Some may even say it was, in fact, already there. But I'm open-minded. But at the same time, I was a little nervous about this Spock thing. Because if it went the wrong direction, it would have really just kind of put the nail in the coffin for Star Trek. And yet, if anything, it breathed new life into Star Trek. Everyone connected with these new faces. And the fact, and it wasn't just nostalgia. Because that was our biggest fear. Are they going to use nostalgia as a way to cheat? Like, hey, guys, remember the Enterprise?
Yeah.
Hey, guys, remember number one?
I remember me and you at the end of
season
David,
one. You remember Spock?
Yeah.
You remember tricorders?
But I remember at the end of season one, Discovery, me and you were like looking at, we're thinking about that whole scene where the Enterprise shows up, and me and you were like going, this is way too soon. Are you kidding
me? Oh, yeah.
No way. You're going to leave it on a cliffhanger that, oh, the Enterprise just shows up. And then it's
and
like,
that's what we were afraid of. We were afraid it was just going to be nostalgia.
A nostalgia member berry moment.
But fortunately, it was anything. It was everything but that.
It was everything but that.
They really did push the story of Star Trek forward by bringing in these new characters, but also not relying on them to tell the story, because that was another thing. Are you not confident in your Discovery crew? Are you going to undermine your Discovery crew by bringing in Enterprise crew? And they did not do that. So we can both agree that everything we got in Discovery Season 2 was fantastic. So for them to give us these Short Treks episodes that, for the most part, were focused on, number one, Spock and Pike, even the Tribbles episode, we still were able to see Pike at the beginning, the opening 2 or 3 minutes. And yes, it's not a lot, but that's enough to give us this. I want to say we had a nice little arc there for those three episodes, a nice little Pike arc reminding us that, hey, Pike is out there still.
Yeah, he's still out there. And it made us as the audience now connect those actors now to those characters fully.
Yeah.
Like, Rebecca Romijn as number one is a must now.
Oh, she's always been number one.
Ethan Peck.
For me.
The Ethan Peck casting, that's been interesting because I remember when Ethan Peck first got casted, Star Trek fans were up in arms.
I wasn't on board.
And everyone was against it. But now, Ethan's done such a really great job that people said, yeah, we want to see Ethan Peck as Spock more now, especially at the way they ended Discovery on him. And then these past three episodes of Short Trek just keep showing that these three actors, including Anson Mount, who arguably has probably become the biggest fan favorite out of Star Trek right now.
I would agree. I'd say him, Spock, and Saru are probably the top three most popular Star Trek characters of the new era of Star Trek right now.
And more popular than the main character.
Yeah.
Me and you have stated that could have been a problem, but it's amazing that what they've been able to do by not damaging Star Trek, but still adding that excitement with these characters.
Yeah. No, I agree. And now that takes us to this discussion here, where we were finally able to get a Pike-centric episode. We finally got a Short Treks episode that focused, for the most part, on Pike. It was the shortest running time of all the previous Short Treks to date. And yet, this is a testament to good writing.
Yeah.
Because it felt full, it felt complete. And the fact that it was written almost as a moment, moments that we all go through in life. Obviously, we're not presented with these types of high-stakes scenarios. However, this is something that I think a lot of audiences can connect to or relate to, a decision, a decision must be made. You have to make a decision. And the way they set this whole entire narrative up, it was almost like a battle of wills.
Yes.
You know, whose willpower is going to resist? You know, whose willpower is going to win over each other? That doesn't even make sense. Let me backtrack again. That's what happens when you don't have show notes, Dave. And I blame you. So stupid. It was set up as a bit of, yeah, I guess that's the best way to say it. Maybe I did say it right.
No,
the battle of wills.
Yeah.
Who has the strongest willpower and who's right? Who's wrong? Obviously, the cadet in this situation proved to be right. But how do you have that type of strength to go against your captain? And that's an interesting angle they took, especially Dave. And I don't know if this is their way to say, hey, you know what? We didn't make a bad decision in season one when Burnham defied the orders of her captain.
Of her captain.
I almost felt like they were going into that territory again. When is it okay to disobey orders and when is it not?
Yes.
And the way they set that up, it in a lot of ways, and I think a lot of people would feel like it is a no-win situation. And that's why a lot of people are comparing this to the Kobayashi Maru.
Yeah, the Kobayashi Maru test. And I love the fact that that basically got brought up, but also when you put it into the kind of narrative bubble that here's this cadet who is starstruck basically because she's talking to Captain Christopher Pike, captain of the USS Enterprise. His name carries weight, and this cadet has to kind of look beyond that and say, he may be important, but I still have to do what's quote unquote right. And that's what I loved about this episode.
Based on Starfleet rules.
Based on Starfleet rules.
Not based on emotion. Exactly. Not based on loyalty. Based on Starfleet rules.
And it gave an insight into that. Because I think a lot of people get that wrong. Is like, oh, Starfleet's all about unicorns and rainbows and doing the right thing. Doing the right thing can be really difficult.
Sometimes doing the wrong thing is the right thing. So stupid.
No, it's not stupid. It's actually right.
It's not right.
It is, because if you think about it, look what she did. She did the wrong thing.
Okay, see, your argument that you're forming is the very thing they're trying to remove from Starfleet, which I don't know if I necessarily agree with that. Do you really want to rip the human element out of decision making? Do you get what I'm saying? And that's why, yes, there was a definitive argument made and a definitive point.
Yeah.
Starfleet rules and regulations. However, how many times have we seen Picard and Captain Kirk captain based on emotions, based on subjectivity, not objectivity? So there's an argument to be made that sometimes you have to fly a little more loose and casual, but that's also the difference between Pike and the other captains.
And the other captains.
What did number one say to Spock in the very first Short Treks episode of this season? Pike isn't sentimental. When you're not sentimental, you're also not really governed by emotions. Not saying outside of his responsibilities as a Starfleet captain, he isn't an emotional person. But when he puts on that uniform, it's business.
It's business. He is Starfleet through and through.
Yeah, and I like that distinction there because that's something that we have to do as we truck along here decade after decade with new captains. In order for us to be drawn to these different individuals, we have to make sure that each of them are distinct and each of them are their own. And we can say that for sure up to this point. We can definitely say that about every single captain we've had. Picard, Sisko, Captain James T. Kirk, Janeway.
Janeway, yeah.
Archer. All the captains have been very, very different. And they've all had their own distinct way of commanding. And now Pike also has distinguished himself as one of our captains. And how funny is it, Dave, that as a guest star, a co-starring, maybe even a story B of season 2 of Discovery, and now Short Treks, we now look at Pike as one of the captains, do we not?
Yeah. And it's amazing too when you put it into the scope that for some of those captains, it takes seasons. It takes years for us to get a gauge of
the with Picard for maybe season two. I didn't dislike him. I thought Patrick Stewart was solid gold in terms of performance from the very first moment we saw him in Encounter at Farpoint. But it wasn't until season two that I really truly was emotionally invested
into him as a captain.
Yeah.
And then like with Pike, he was a guest star in probably season two, and it's only taken
when
I think about it now, yeah, is like even he wasn't even full focus on season two.
No, not at all.
And then in three short episodes that are 10 minutes long, we've gotten so much development in Captain Pike.
Yeah, and that's why I feel like this episode of Short Treks is a win, and why I feel like Kalinda Vaquez and Armit Kerr did such a great job with this episode, because again, short stories are not easy.
They're not easy,
Dave. You and I years ago both went to film school together. That's why we're buddies and we do all these discussions and do a bunch of other things. But we know firsthand, short films are not easy. Just because it's short doesn't mean your job is that much easier. Oh, I only have to do a little bit of work. No.
No.
From the writing aspect, you still need to make sure you have a complete story there. And this episode not only gave us a complete story in the form of a moment, or even you can rephrase that and say in a form of a decision, but also it said so much about Pike as a character. And this is why Anson Mount as an actor probably signed up for this. When you're an actor like Anson Mount, who's a fairly big actor, why would you come back for a 9-minute episode? Well, okay. What does it say? What does it say about the character that he obviously loves? And what does it do for the character?
Yeah.
And that's why you can easily see why he came back to do these, because of the impact this episode would have on his core development as a character. It's brilliant work.
It's absolutely brilliant work. And then it makes us as fans want to see more, an actual full-fledged Enterprise series with Anson Mount leading it.
In my mind, Dave, there is more. Okay? When I close my eyes, I pretend we had an entire season.
We had an entire season of just Ethan, Rebecca, and Anson.
And at moments, just Rebecca Romijn. At moments, just her and me. For some reason, I managed to project myself into those seasons.
And loosening her uniform.
No, she can do it herself. Hands off. I don't want to be inappropriate.
You don't want to be inappropriate.
Yeah. But this is my own fan fiction, so maybe I will get a little rough.
Remember, that's why we have the holodeck.
Maybe I will get a little rough, Dave. This is my fan fiction. And perhaps I will make a holodeck program based on that. Fantasy?
Fantasy.
But overall, the episode was strong. The acting was great, of course. The score, I felt really cut through as well. And that's something that I don't think we've had big problems with. I think you and I have both really connected with the Discovery score overall, even from season one. But even this episode, I thought was really strong. And the composer, Andrea Datsman, she is the woman that composed a score for this episode, and interestingly, she has worked with Michael Giacchino. Is that how you say that? Giacchino? Yeah.
I think so.
Uncultured, once again. Uncultured.
Once again, yeah.
And she has worked with him on all the previous Star Trek movie scores that he has worked on. So she isn't new to the Star Trek game. She has worked with him. She obviously has been immersed in Star Trek themes before, and you can tell. There's a sense of familiarity there to her composing. She understands the vibe of the music that needs to bring all of us in, the Star Trek viewers, bring us into Star Trek and help us along, help us feel like we are, in fact, or I should say that we have been, in fact, transported to this world momentarily.
Yeah, to this universe. Because, mm-hmm. like, you're right. While the score wasn't in your face, Star Trek, the little nuances that basically it had throughout this episode just made you feel, okay, I'm watching an episode of Star Trek. But I wouldn't even say an episode. I'm watching a film of Star Trek. Because, like, the score definitely reminds me of, like, the old movies.
Yeah.
It doesn't remind me of, like, the TV show, but it reminds me of the movies, and it gave it that cinematic quality to it that made it a little bit more special.
Yeah. I agree. Now, the writer, Kalinda Vasquez, she has written a number of high-profile TV shows. This is her first hand at writing Star Trek. This is her first try at Star Trek, and I think she definitely succeeded.
Oh, absolutely.
She's written on Nikita, Once Upon a Time, and Fear the Walking Dead. So she's definitely not a noob. This is what she's been doing. The director has worked on various music videos of sorts, but it looked like they made their transition into narrative storytelling.
Yeah,
I think quite successfully. I think they did a good job.
Well, not only that, when you take a look at the story that she wrote, it wasn't... I really appreciate the fact that it's not the type of story where one side is wrong and the other side is right. It makes the audience question, like, it makes the audience question what would they do, mm-hmm. you know?
Well, yeah.
And that's what me and you constantly
harp on. What
would
you do, David?
You know what? I would have actually probably sided with Anson Mount.
Yeah, me too. I would have failed.
Because
I would be like, all right, let's do this shit.
Because here's the thing. Yes, follow Starfleet regulations, but you're asking me to choose the life of my family.
Well, dude, look at Star Trek 3, where everyone threw out all rules and regulations out the window
yeah.
and hijacked the USS Enterprise and went off to go save Spock. All because of their loyalty. Look at Picard. I will understand if you guys don't want to join me on this. To hell with orders, sir. And they all go after the Borg. I mean, how many times have we seen where the crew has thrown regulation right out the window?
Well, shoot. My favorite scene by far when they did that, which is the funniest one, is Undiscovered Country at the very end when Kirk gets the call that they say, oh, he has to dock the Enterprise for decommission.
Yeah.
And what does Spock do? Yeah, what does Spock do? He says, I believe the phrase, if I were human, would be go to hell. And I'm like going, that's what all of us would do. But I love the fact that they turned the argument on its head because
I think they showed the reality of
the
situation.
The reality of the situation.
Rather than the romanticized idea of loyalty and, you know, friendship. This is more a realistic, grounded look at
yes.
what your decision as a Starfleet, you know, science/military officer would have to make.
Yeah. And like afterwards, I was like going, well, damn, she made a tough call. But the fact that Pike was teaching her also, it was a way of Pike telling us as the audience, hey, this is Starfleet. This is what I believe in as the captain. You have to make those tough calls. And sometimes those calls are going to cost you, but you live with it because this is the life you chose. And I really dug that last part of the whole episode where Anson Mount as Pike is like really apologetic. Like he's like, your husband is alive. It's okay. It's all right. Put the phaser down.
Yeah, it was. I feel like everything worked. It was a charming episode.
It was well written.
It was well directed. I mean, Anson Mount oozes charisma for days. So that guy can be on screen in one set, which is what it was, one scene for the most part, and he can make it work. And then you throw in a good actor to work alongside him, and boom, you got yourself a pretty nice little short there.
Yeah.
So, Dave, I think the saddest thing about all this, going right back to what we said at the top of the show, is what does this mean? What does this mean for the Enterprise crew at this point? Is this the last time we're going to see them? I refuse to think. I refuse to believe this will be the last time we see this crew.
I think I'm with you on that. I think this would be a shame if this was the last time we would see the original Enterprise crew as they are. Those characters.
Pike, number one, and Spock.
Pike,
yes.
Number one and Spock. I think it would be a missed opportunity to really add to the history of Star Trek.
I agree. And we've said this on other discussions, Dave. And in this era of streaming, right, we're in what a lot of people are calling, especially in this last month, CBS All Access had the foresight to get started on this two and a half, three years before everyone else decided to start doing this. You know, they saw the signs. And they were one of the first networks to say, let's do this. And they went all in with original content like Star Trek. And in this day and age where we're in the streaming wars, we have Apple TV now. We have Disney Plus. We have DCU, Hulu, Amazon, obviously Netflix. And the list goes on and on and on. The upcoming AT&T Warner Brothers streaming service. So much. A lot of these new streaming services have also announced that they're not going to just be doing original TV shows. They're going to be doing original films.
Films. Yep.
I could easily see CBS All Access saying, hey, maybe we don't want to commit to an ongoing series for various reasons. Let's say they just can't find a way to fit it in with all of their shows they have planned right now. Also, maybe the whole time frame might offer whole different types of issues because of continuity.
Yeah.
Dealing with the fact that we're going to end up running right up against the Kirk era. We got to be very, very careful. So why not produce a film? A CBS All Access original film. A 2-hour film with this Enterprise crew. Shit, do 2 or 3 of them. Every year, release a new feature film centered around the Enterprise crew. It would be a huge hit, Dave. I'm telling you now.
It would be. I mean, like, yes, we all know what the fate of these characters are. We do. We know the fate of Pike. We know the fate of Spock.
But we don't know what happened before leading up necessarily.
Yeah, we don't. The funny part is we don't know the fate of number one.
And it doesn't need to be some foreboding movie where it's like, oh my God.
Oh, yeah.
Here it comes. He's going to die now. Give us, forget all that. We know what's going to happen to him.
Just give us an original story.
And maybe have like this really intimate arc with Pike and give him the Captain Kirk, Captain Picard treatment. Give him that intimate storyline, connect him with his crew, and then maybe in the last movie, have that final movie end where we all know his fate ends up going. Or ends up being, I should say.
Ends up being, yeah.
I mean, that, fuck, dude. That's what I'm talking about. We could do it. I think it would be a huge missed opportunity.
I really think now that Kurtzman has shown his hand of what Star Trek's capable of, because let's make no mistake, the last bits of Star Trek have been amazing. I know, just like what you said at the top of the show, that basically you have your hardcore fans out there that wanna rally against the wind, but
They're not going to win. They're because, David, like all of us, we're an aging, I always say this.
We are an aging demographic.
We are an aging fan base. And honestly, unfortunately, we don't effing matter.
Yeah.
We don't. What matters is the young generation. And if they can pacify us while also bringing in new audiences, that's their focus.
Yeah.
I mean, they're not going to ever say it, but that's business.
That's business. And honestly, the last bits of Star Trek we've gotten have been amazing. And they've done wonders for...
I've enjoyed it.
Not just the franchise, but the entire narrative of the universe of Star Trek. They've made so many nods and explanations to the universe. They've given us answers in subtle ways that I'm like going, they got to continue this. And the best way to continue it, because we all know the Discovery crew for now is all the way in the future. They are far from the past now. They're like thousands upon thousands of years been flung into the future. Okay. So they can't explain anything in the past. But you know what crew can explain? The Enterprise crew.
Well, even if we don't, you know, focus the series on explaining things from the past, we don't need to explain anything. That's what I was trying to say. I'm like, yeah, they can fill in some blanks here and there, but that doesn't even need to be the focus. It doesn't need to be looked at as a prequel. Because my biggest problem with prequels, Dave, is, oh, hey, it's a prequel. Hey, this is how so-and-so got that scar on his chin. You remember that scar that we've always seen? Oh, look, this is how so-and-so got that jacket that he loves so much. I feel like prequels focus way too much on explaining how the origin of everything.
The origin of everything.
You remember that one picture you saw on the wall, that one guy's room? Well, this is the guy's roommate, and this is how he got the picture. The roommate gave it to him. I don't think the show needs to be a prequel. Is it going to be a prequel? Obviously, chronologically, everything. Technically, Picard's a prequel now. This upcoming TV show.
Yes.
So, as long, it doesn't need to be written like a prequel. It just needs to take place in a different time frame, chronologically.
And
if the movie focuses on just being its own thing and not on being a prequel, then, hey, it's going to be a fun time. And I feel like they have to do it, Dave, at this point.
Oh, yeah. And I love your explanation about how, like, there's a difference between doing a prequel and doing a original story within a universe that the time frame's different. Timeline's different, right? You could still do an original story. You don't have to, like what you say, explain every single detail and make that your narrative. You can give your own narrative and still show us that we're in Star Trek. Show us that this universe is connected. To kind of connect Star Trek right now, they can do the Marvel way of connecting their universes. That's the way it's done. That's why, especially with this episode, while it was an amazing original story, right? Mm-hmm. An original script.
Right.
They still were able to do little nods that basically say, hey, if you're a hardcore Star Trek fan, you would notice this.
Like what? Go ahead and you have that list there, right? A list of Easter eggs?
Oh, yeah. There was some really smart Easter eggs in this one. I mean, like, first and foremost, the nod to Starbase 28.
Mm-hmm.
Starbase 28, if you're a hardcore Star Trek fan, should know what Starbase 28 is. Starbase 28 has made basically three appearances in Star Trek.
Mm-hmm.
Let me bring it up here so I can get my facts straight. Let's see. There we go. So Starbase 28 first was mentioned in the Mirror Universe in Discovery first. In episode 5 of season 1, Choose Your Pain. The in the Mirror Universe where Lorca is being interrogated and tortured in the pain tubes.
Right, yes.
That's Starbase 28 in the Mirror Universe, which is really cool because if you think about it, she's on Starbase 28 getting tested and getting interrogated, technically interrogated by Pike. So that was a nice, cool little connection to the Mirror Universe and then the known universe. And Starbase 28 does make a appearance in, it says here, in the 1984 novel, The Trelane Confrontation.
Okay.
Where Captain Kirk drops off prisoners.
Right. Yeah, I remember that.
Starbase 28.
And what else? What other Easter eggs do we have there?
We have...
No ums.
Oh, sorry.
No ums. Come on, David. You're a professional. No ums.
Okay. They mentioned the USS Bowman. Mm-hmm. Captain Pike describing the sequence of events to Cadet Sidhu.
Right.
He mentions the USS Bowman. The ship is referenced in the non-canon TOS novel back in 2007, Reap the Whirlwind.
Mm-hmm. There's one other one that this site I'm looking at picked up on, and I didn't pick up on it until I read this and I remembered it. There was that moment where they were, Pike and the cadet were going back and forth, and there's a line where they say, reference to Starfleet's reserve activation clause, which Leonard McCoy in Star Trek The Motion Picture called as well a little known and seldom used clause. So at least these people are doing their research.
Yeah.
Because I'm sure not all of these new writers are diehard Star Trek fans. To a lot of these people, this is just a job. But at least they care enough about the art and the craft to say, you know what? I need to make sure I immerse myself in Star Trek. I understand some things so I can include some references. It's important to them.
It's important to me
as a Star Trek fan, who is a diehard Star Trek fan, you earn points. And that goes a long way for someone like me.
But the biggest one that I thought was the biggest Easter egg for me,
okay,
was the line where he basically says, Pike looks at her and says, it was a trap. They just wanted the Enterprise. And then he tells them that the Tholians wanted the Enterprise.
Right.
And I love the fact that they connected this because, number one.
To what? Go ahead and explain the whole thing.
It's a direct connection to the original series episode, The Tholian Web,
mm-hmm,
where the Tholians are after the Enterprise. So right. It actually connects to the fact that the Tholians have been wanting the Enterprise for a long time.
Very famous episode, yes.
Very famous episode. But also, and if you've been reading Star Trek Year 5, the Tholians make an appearance and look to be a major race in the comic book Star Trek Year 5. And the Tholians.
So is that just a nugget for you then? Because that's not an Easter egg, right? That's just a nugget of why that's cool for you?
That's cool for me.
Yeah. Okay.
Because, like, it's one of those things that basically I really appreciate the fact that they're bringing more attention to more races in Star Trek that should have more attention. I mean, we have a constant focus on Klingons, Vulcans, Romulans, humans.
Right.
There's so many races that seem to get forgotten, and one of those races for me is the Tholians.
Well, the Tholians, for a lot of reasons, and this has been going around for decades, there's been whispers and murmurs. The Tholians were a great idea, but in order to do them just what they are,
the effects,
it's too expensive.
It's too expensive. But nowadays,
I mean, Enterprise did, I believe early on in the first season, we saw the Tholians, and it does not hold up.
It doesn't hold up.
The CGI is, how can I put this gently? It was awful.
It was awful.
It was not good.
But if you've read or if you are reading Star Trek Year 5, you would understand that basically, yeah, if we were able to today cinematically see the Tholians,
and they are able to now with today's budgets.
With today's budgets, my God. Especially it
well, explain what Year 5 is briefly. We're getting off topic here, Dave, but Year 5 is an IDW ongoing series that started about 3-4 months ago,
yes,
no longer than that, maybe 6 or 7 months ago now, and it is the untold year, because we have 4 years of Star Trek. It's the final year 5 of the original Enterprise crew, or I should say of the original series crew now. We're getting so convoluted now. It's no longer the original Enterprise crew. The original series crew, Captain Kirk, Picard, that whole gang. And it's pretty fucking good. So, all right, Dave, any other thing you want to mention before we move on?
That was my last bit of nugget. That's my nugget that I took away from this episode. This episode left me with some really good feels.
Yeah, I do agree with you about the Tholian aspect. It does seem like they're pushing different species nowadays rather than the go-to. And that's something that I really dug that the writers of Enterprise did that. The Enterprise writers were also, even though that show takes a lot of shit,
they tried to push the boundaries.
They did, absolutely. All right, Dave, final thoughts and then your RMD rating.
My RMD rating for this bit of Short Trek, I would easily give this a 88.
Okay.
Four score.
Not 100.
Not 100 because because
I don't need
I'm
to
not,
explain.
I'm going to. I don't want things thrown at me. So afterwards, when I'm done geeking out, I have to actually take a look at it and go, okay, what are those other things that you could say are negatives? There are a couple flaws in it. 9 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Whew,
that's tight.
But is that a fan want or critical?
I think it's a critical want. because you could have easily probably
was there
extended
a,
it to 15.
Hold on, Dave. Was there a complete story? If there was a complete story, then you shouldn't even bring that up. Unless it really bothered you. If it really affected you, then okay, bring it up.
No, it really affected me because like I really was like going, okay, we're dropped into this scenario and it's almost like a roller coaster ride where it's like, okay, here we go, going down, going through the ride. 5 seconds later, the ride's over. And I had that feeling at the end. It's almost like it felt incomplete to me. I do agree with you. I cannot say that this is an incomplete story because when you read the script and you look at the story and the dialogue between the two characters, it's very, very tight. So it's a, it's borderline a fan want for me that basically it's too short, but it's also
I
for
think,
me.
I think the RMD score is the worst thing that ever happened to you.
It is.
It's completely made you suck as a reviewer. You're like, I like it, but I don't like it.
I know. It's been really tough, but I will get better.
I've never disagreed with your final thoughts until we started the score. And I'm like, that doesn't even make sense. I hate you.
I have to take away points on something.
Oh, Steven. So anything else you want to add?
Briefly? No. Overall, okay. I'm really happy with Short Treks.
Okay. All right. My final thoughts, I thought it was great. I disagree with you about the... No, I agree with you about the roller coaster feeling, but I feel like that's the point. There was a sense of intensity and urgency that was, you know, thrusted upon us, and that was done by the awesome way the narrative was written out and scripted out, and the way it was directed. It was a scene that needed high intensity. You're talking about making decisions in a very quick fashion.
Snap fashion.
Yeah. Rapid fire rules being fired back and forth, which I thought was fucking brilliant, number one. The fact that they were battling by using Starfleet code, I'm like, that's so nerdy, and it's so Star Trek. I love it. I give this episode a 90%. I really, really thought it was good. Yes, as a fan, as a greedy fan, I wanted something longer than 9 minutes. But when you take a step back, it's nine minutes of a solid, well-crafted, complete story. So that will conclude this week's discussion on, or this discussion on Star Trek Short Treks. Ask Not the second or third episode. Dude, I am all out of sorts. I think you made me mad. This concludes our discussion on Star Trek Short Treks. Ask Not. I want to thank everyone for listening. Well, we will be back with more discussions and breakdowns on everything and anything Star Trek. Thank you, David.
Thank you. Live long and prosper.